The last people dropping in, maybe some more will come, I don't know. I didn't really know what to expect of the number of people who come. So if I want to start right away because I have a lot to say. I have 40 slides in 45 minutes, so time-wise it's going to be a bit of a challenge. So I see a couple of familiar faces, but also a lot that I don't know, so I want to start with shortly introducing myself. My name is Martin Opdam. Yep. As of 3 days ago, I'm 44 years old. I live in Zoetermeer, and I'm married. I have a daughter of 15 and a son of 10. And I work as a software developer for Aviva Solutions. And today I'm here to talk about artificial intelligence. So who knows what artificial intelligence is? Just raise your hand. It's not a trick question. Okay, not so many. Who's a developer? Who's a software developer here? Ah, most of you. Good. Developers. And who knows what a neural network is or how it works? A few. Yeah, I know you. And who thinks artificial intelligence is a threat to us, to humans in general? Not so many. Well, a few. Right, but it might be, right? Because for the past thousands of years, we humans have ruled the Earth. Of all the species that exist, we are the most advanced, and that lets us determine everything. So we determine what animals we put in cages, what animals we eat, and what animals we kill whenever they get in the way of reaching our goals. Sounds harsh, but that's what we're doing. And we can do all that, not because we're the biggest or the strongest, but we can do that because we are the most intelligent. So intelligence is apparently something that's more important than size or strength. Because our intelligence enables us to do inventions and to work together in a way that made us the number one species on this planet. And that's a cool place to be. And now we're working on a new invention, artificial intelligence. But artificial intelligence is the first thing that we're creating that has the potential of becoming more intelligent than we are. So that would make us the number two species on the planet. Thank you. And that might have some consequences. Now, to be honest, there are different opinions about this. Some people believe artificial intelligence is just a hype, will never be a big thing. Others think that it will make our lives infinitely better. But there is also a group of people who thinks it will be our final invention. So it's a controversial topic in that sense. And maybe before I continue, it's good to make a short disclaimer. If you haven't heard a lot about AI before, then some of the things I'm about to tell might sound a bit weird. But then remember, I'm not making this up myself. These are ideas of scientists with years of experience in this field. So this talk will just be a fast overview, and I forgot to put the timer on, of everything you can come across when you start learning about AI. So I will show you how it started, how it evolved, what it can do today, and what it might do in the future. And I want to set my timer because I have a really tight schedule. So, and the key thing I think what I want to convey in this talk is that you should have an open mind about what the future might look like. And that what seems like science fiction today might be closer than we think. So enough introduction for now. I want to start with a short video, and after that I will have a question for you.
No orientation. No guidebook. Figuring out how it works is half the fun. All you do is make choices. Starting here, everything is bespoke and exactly your size. You want to ask, so ask.
Are you real?
Well, if you can't tell, does it matter?
Yeah, if you can't tell, does it matter? It's a nice philosophical question. This is a scene from Westworld. Who does not know the series Westworld? Okay, so most of you do. Well, for those who don't, Westworld is a series about kind of a futuristic theme park where artificial intelligent robots like this lady have to entertain the guests. In short, what it's about. But that was not my question. My question is, what test did this woman pass? Turing test, I heard it, very good. Indeed, this is Alan Turing, and Alan Turing was a mathematician, and he was one of the founders of the computer. He's also the guy who, in the Second World War, invented the machine that cracked the German Enigma code, key turning point in the war. So he was a very smart man, and he asked himself the question, is it possible that we create a machine that can imitate a human so well that we cannot tell the difference? And he called this the imitation game, and later that got better known as the Turing test. And it basically says if you're communicating via written text with both a computer and a human, but you cannot be sure which is the computer and which is the human, then the computer has passed the Turing test. So up until today, no computer has ever passed this test. But it does show that artificial intelligence is not a very new topic. It started out in the 50s, right after the invention of the computer, and the first conference was held in 1956, organized by this man, John McCarthy. And it was a six-week period where 11 scientists came together and wanted to do research on computers that would be capable of reasoning, abstract thinking, problem solving, and self-improvement. Now, note this is 1956, so there were no computers like we have them today. So these were pretty far-reaching ideas that these men had. One of them was also Marvin Minsky, and yeah, these men are seen as the fathers of AI, pioneers in this field. But despite all their good intentions, we're now more than 60 years later, and there's still no computer that passes the Turing test. So you might say, what's the big deal with AI? Why would we worry about it? And yet there is a group of scientists who believe that we are currently on the brink of what they call an intelligence explosion, an increase in artificial intelligence so fast that we humans cannot keep up. And to understand why they think that, we need to take a step back in time and see how technology has evolved. And when I say take a step back, I mean a huge step back. We're going to skip the first few billion years of the Earth when there was only simple life, but we're going to start 2 million years ago in the hunter-gatherer's age. And it's going to get more interesting than this, I promise, but just bear with me. So hunter-gatherer's age, people lived in small groups, roaming around from place to place, depending on where the food was. And what was remarkable about this time is that there was no technology. So they didn't have fire, they didn't have language, they couldn't speak with each other. And humans lived like this for almost 2 million years. It's a very long time. And then around 50,000 before Christ, they invented language, if you want to call it an invention. So they started talking to each other. And that's a big enabler for further progress because it allowed them to communicate with each other, learn from each other, share ideas. But still, progress in this age was spread out over hundreds of thousands of years. So during a life, a human did not see any change, right? Generation after generation, life on Earth for humans was just exactly the same. And then around 10,000 before Christ, this age transitioned into the agricultural age, and people no longer roamed around, but they started living closer together, forming the first villages. And because they already had language, living closer together made it even easier for them to work together, share ideas, learn from each other, in other words, to make progress. And with the invention of the book printing in 1450, around that time, it even became possible to share ideas over generations, and it's something that we're still having the benefits of every day. But still, progress in this age was spread out over hundreds of years, so during their lives, people did not see any change. You were born, you died, and in between, life was just the same. And then around 1760, this age transitioned into the industrial age. Started with the invention of the steam engine, and we went from using our hands to creating products to using machines, and that allowed for a lot faster progress. So it's estimated that between 1800 and 1900, there was more technological progress than in the 9 centuries before that. So progress in this age is spread out over a couple of decades, so people started to see a little bit of progress during their lives. And then around 1950, this age transitioned into the information age, and that's what we're still living in today. And in the information age, technological progress follows each other rapidly. I've compiled a list of some of the things that were invented since the 50s, but this is far from complete. And so progress in our age is spread out over only a few years, and that means that humans see a lot of progress during their lives, right? The year that we were born was completely different from the time that we're living on now. But realize that's the first time in the entire history of the Earth that that is the case. So these are just some examples of the progress that we have made in the past 100 years alone. And this is pretty impressive, if you ask me. I mean, compare this to the 2 million years before, and you can see that we're living in a very special time. And we could do all this progress that you see here, we could do it with the knowledge and technology from the previous century. So what should be possible with the knowledge and the technology that we have today should be much more impressive, I think. So to somebody from the year 1750, so from before the Industrial Revolution, our world of technology and comfort and medical care would seem nothing short but magical. And it keeps going on because these were devices that were cool when I was a kid, but only one generation later, my children don't even know what these devices are. They do know the functionality of each device because, that's right there in their pocket. So you see there's a pattern that you can recognize here. And that is that we first had a few billion years on Earth when there was only simple life. And then we had a couple of million years in the hunter-gatherer's age when there was no technology. And then a couple of thousand years in the agricultural age when there was hardly any technology. And then a couple of hundred years in the industrial age when there was a little technological progress. And now we're living only a couple of decades in the information age and there is a lot of technological progress. Now that pattern of ever-increasing speed in technological progress is what Ray Kurzweil calls the law of accelerating returns. Kurzweil, you might know him as the inventor of the synthesizer and optical text recognition software, and currently he is the director of engineering at Google. No idea what that title means, but that's what he is. And what he says actually makes sense. Sounds like it makes sense, because he says every invention that you make, every progress that you make, gives you more powerful tools to work on the next progress, and therefore technological progress follows an exponential pattern. But because we as a species have evolved for millions of years without seeing any technological progress, our brains are more or less programmed to think linearly, and therefore we're constantly underestimating the speed at which technology evolves. Now, sounds like it makes sense. Still, not everybody agrees with him. He gets a lot of criticism. But of the 147 predictions that he has made since the 90s, 86% appear to be correct. So apparently he is somebody with a more than average feeling of how technology evolves. And he says, he predicts, that by the year 2029, so that's 10 years from now, we will have computers that pass the Turing test, that we cannot distinguish from human intelligence. 86% chance. So to visualize what exponential growth look like, this is Lake Michigan, or a schematical view of it. And Lake Michigan is one of the biggest lakes in the world. It has an average depth of 85 meters. Now imagine it's 1940 and the lake is completely empty and you're allowed to throw in one fluid ounce of water in the lake. So it's about 30 milliliters, not so much. And then every year and a half, every 18 months, you're allowed to double the contents of the lake. What you then have is an exponential growth pattern. And what it looks like is that the first few years you will not see much happening. It looks like there's hardly any progress. In fact, it would take until the year 2010 before you would see the first puddles appear. And in the year 2019, where we're now, there would be about 5 meters of water in the lake. Now, if you think linearly, you would say from 1940 to 2019, that's 79 years, we've reached 5 meters. So it's going to take at least 1,200 years before we have filled the entire lake. That is if you think linearly. But with an exponential growth pattern, it looks a bit different. Because indeed, at first, it goes slow, looks like hardly any progress. But then all of a sudden, it speeds up. And it will not take you another 1,200 years to fill the lake, but only 6 more years. And in the year 2025, you're done. So that's the power of exponential growth. And exponential growth and the law of accelerating returns are some of the reasons why scientists believe that we're on the brink of an intelligence explosion. So everything we have achieved so far with computing and with AI is only the first 5 meters of the lake. And in the next decade, we're going to fill the entire 85 meters of the lake. Still, a lot of people are not really aware that this is coming. They're not really aware that this technology might change their lives. And that's probably because most people don't really know what it is. I mean, I asked the question, what is AI? Yeah, a few hands raised, but not much. So if you don't know what it is, it's really hard to imagine that something will change your life. We saw the same thing before the internet existed.
Well, Allison should know. What do you say internet that? Internet is that massive computer
right.
network.
The one that's becoming really big now.
What do you mean, next big? How does one, what do you write to it, like mail?
No, a lot of people use it and communicate. I guess they can communicate with NBC writers and producers. Allison, can you explain what internet is?
Yeah, so this, I think it's funny. We can laugh about this today, but this is only 25 years ago. People just didn't know what the internet was, couldn't imagine the impact it would have on their lives. But this is how we are talking about AI today. We really don't know what it is, so we cannot imagine the impact it will have on our lives. And we can definitely not imagine that it will become more intelligent than we are. But the fact that we cannot imagine it does not mean that it will never happen. I mean, the people from 1750 could also not have imagined our world of technology, and yet that is the world that we are living in every day. So maybe we just have to get a bit better in believing in the impossible. So we've seen how AI has started in the 50s. Now let's look at how it evolved. And one nice way of looking at that is how it is used in games. So this is the ADSEC computer. It was built in 1949 on the University of Cambridge. And in 1952, it could play tic-tac-toe. And then 45 years later, it was IBM's Deep Blue that beat Garry Kasparov. And that was then the world champion in chess. And Deep Blue was programmed with human logic about the game of chess. And it used its computational power, so brute force, to calculate through millions of moves. And in that way, it was able to defeat Kasparov. Ray Kurzweil, by the way, already predicted this. In 1989, he wrote a book in which he predicted that by the year 2000, computers would beat humans at chess. It was actually 3 years earlier, but this was one of his correct predictions. And then 14 years later, it was again IBM with their Watson computer that defeated two of the best Jeopardy players. And Jeopardy is a game where you get general knowledge questions. And Watson was able to interpret the question and then do a lookup through books, articles, encyclopedia, and then come up with the right answer. And then 5 years later, it was DeepMind's AlphaGo that defeated Lisa Dahl. And Lisa Dahl was the 18-time world champion in the game Go. for people who don't know what Go is, that's what it looks like. I also don't know the rules of the game, but it is a more complex game than chess, because the number of legal board positions in the game is bigger than the total number of atoms in the universe. So that's massive. And that means that brute force is not going to help you this time, because there's no computer powerful enough to calculate through all the possible moves. And another problem is that when professional Go players are... there's actually professional Go players. When they're asked about their strategy of how they play, they say they can't really explain it, because they play by intuition. And that makes it a really hard game to implement, because if they cannot explain how they're doing it, then how are you going to write a program for it? And that's why it was thought that it would take at least another 10 years before computers would beat humans at Go. But DeepMind did it in 2016. Now, AlphaGo was not a conventional computer program, but instead it used neural networks. And they trained these neural networks, because that's what you do with a neural network. I'll get back to that later. They trained it with millions of moves from human players. And then after that, it got better by playing against itself using a technique called reinforcement learning. It means that it learns from its failures and from its successes. There's a nice documentary on Netflix about this, if you're interested. Then 1 year later, they improved the algorithm that they had, and they called it AlphaZero, so no longer AlphaGo, but AlphaZero. And AlphaZero was not programmed or not trained with human moves, but instead it was only programmed with the basic knowledge of the game Go, and then it learned how to play it by playing against itself. And in only 3 days of training like this, it had gotten better than the previous version of AlphaGo. And then they used this exact same algorithm, and they also taught it how to play chess. And within only a couple of hours, it had become the best chess computer in the world. So you see, once we get the algorithm right, neural networks can become really good, really fast. Last year, OpenAI is a company where Elon Musk was also involved in. Had set itself a goal of creating bots for the game Dota 2. I don't know the game, but it's from what I see and read, it's a much more complex or much different game than chess or Go. Because you play on a field in a team of five against another team of five, and each player only sees a small part of the map. So you don't know where all the other players are, what they're doing. So it's a difficult game to write a bot for. And OpenAI created a team of five bots based on neural networks, and they trained them, and when they had gotten good enough, they could participate in The International. And The International is like the world championship of Dota 2. Crazy amount of money that you can win there. There they played, and they were defeated 2 times by human professional players. So for now, Dota 2 is still played best by humans. But mind you, only the best of the best humans, right? Average player doesn't stand a chance. And then at the beginning of this year, in January, DeepMind showed off their StarCraft bot, AlphaStar. And AlphaStar was also based on neural networks, and it was trained with data from replays of human games. And then the resulting bot, after this training, they cloned it, and they let it play against itself, against each other, in some sort of a tournament. And they trained them like this for 1 week, in which they played an equivalent of 200 years of StarCraft gameplay. And then it had gotten so good that it defeated 2 professional players. Now, admittedly, it could only play on a single map that was designed specifically for AI research, and it could only play one of the 3 types of characters in the game, and there were a couple of other restrictions that would make this an unfair comparison. But there's no denying that these neural network-based bots are becoming really, really powerful. So neural networks play an important role in AI, in the current rise of AI. But what are they, neural networks? So that is really hard to explain. So I'm going to give it a try using this image, Jip and Janneke style, so to say. So over the course of evolution, the human brain has gotten extremely well at recognizing patterns in images. So for us, it's really easy to see what is the difference between an image of a chihuahua and an image of a muffin. Easy task. But when I ask you to explain what the difference is, then the task becomes a lot harder, because both have more or less the same color, more or less the same shape, a couple of dark spots on them. So really hard to explain what is the difference. That's called Polanyi's paradox. We know what the difference is, but we cannot tell. Now, the difference between a conventional computer program and a neural network is this, but with conventional computer programs, you would have to implement, line by line, all the logic that describes what is the difference between an image of a chihuahua and one of a muffin. And like we just established, it's hard to explain, so also hard to implement. I wouldn't even know where to start. But with a neural network, it's completely different. A neural network is a generic algorithm with a lot of parameters, and you train this algorithm by feeding it example images. And after each example, the network will make a prediction of what it thinks it is, and you will correct it with the right answer. And after each example, the network will make tiny changes to all of its parameters. And after feeding it enough examples, millions of examples, that's what you need, after feeding it enough, all the parameters in the network will have been set in such a way that it will make the correct prediction most of the time. And then you call the network trained. So there's different types of neural networks. One is more complex than the other, but in general, this is how they all work. Now, the human brain is mainly good at recognizing patterns in images, but neural networks can recognize patterns in any type of data, and that makes them extremely powerful. The only thing is, they need a lot of examples for training, so we need a lot of data. But we live in a world where we have a lot of data, because more and more devices are getting equipped with sensors that register information, and with the oncoming wave of the Internet of Things, that's only going to become more. So we have enough data, more data than any user could make sense of. So we need intelligent machines to do that for us. And we also have a lot of personal data, because every search that you do, every video that you watch, every like, every post, every tweet, all of that gives information about ourselves, says something about who you are, what you like, what your values are, what your preferences are, both personal and political. And that's very valuable information these days. So it makes sense that companies like Google and Facebook invest a lot of money in this technology, because they have a lot of this data. But they're not the only ones, because AI is no longer just used in the realm of scientific research, but instead it's being invested in by big companies. And some examples of applications today are speech recognition and speech synthesis, like, for example, Siri, Cortana, Alexa. Last year, Google showed off what their assistant is capable of during the Google I.O. conference. Maybe you already seen this video, but I'm watching.
How can I help you? Hi, I'm calling to book a woman's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd. Mm-hmm. Sure, what time are you looking for around? At 12 p.m. We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15. Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.? Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for? Just a woman's haircut for now. Okay, we have a 10 o'clock. 10 a.m. is fine. Okay, what's her first name? The first name is Lisa. Okay, perfect. So I will see Lisa at 10 o'clock on May 3rd. Okay, great. Thanks. Great. Have a great day. Bye.
Now, for the record, this is by no means a proof of a successful Turing test, by no means. But it does show the amazing capabilities of speech synthesis and speech recognition these days. I mean, imagine what this can do in 10 years, right? So another example of an application today is translation. At the end of 2016, Google has replaced their entire translation engine with one that's based on neural networks. And with that, they made a major improvement in the quality of the translation and also the number of languages that they can translate. Image recognition, another example. Facebook uses that, for example, to analyze what's happening in the pictures that you like or who is in the picture that you like, so that they know what it is that you like and who it is that you like. That's information that they want to have. Medical diagnosis, another example. Neural networks are becoming better and better at recognizing patterns and anomalies in MRI scans and in X-ray photos. And it can be a great assistance to doctors to make faster diagnosis. And of course, autonomous vehicles, another example. They're full of neural networks that take in all the input from the sensors in the car and translate that to actions like steer left, steer right, hit the brakes, accelerate, etc. So a lot of examples of neural networks and AI, as they call it in general, that's being used today. Yeah, so what can AI do in 10 years? Well, it's a fact that right now the best chess player is no longer human, the best Go player is no longer human, Dota 2 and StarCraft will soon no longer be best played by humans. Last year was the first time that computers won parts of the Stanford Comprehensive Reading Contest, so they're getting better at parsing text. Microsoft created a translation machine last year from Chinese to English that was on par with the translations made by a human. And this list is growing every day. So yeah, what can AI do in 10 years? Well, a lot of people are still skeptical, and maybe that's because there has always been a lot of hype around AI. Ever since the beginning, we were promised intelligent machines, and so far AI has not been able to live up to the promises. So yeah, why would it be different this time? Why would it not be another round of hype? Well, three reasons to believe that. And one is we have better algorithms right now. And the other is that although the ideas behind these algorithms have been around for quite some time, we now also have the fast computers, the computational power to work with these algorithms. And we have a lot of data to train the algorithms. And those three things combined are now coming together, and that's reason for people to believe that AI will really take off this time. Andrew Ng from Baidu, he's a really big player in AI, he thinks that AI will be the new electricity. And that means it will be around everywhere, and people will expect it to be everywhere. And it will transform entire industries, just like electricity has done. Now, that all sounds nice, but there are also some risks involved. As with every new technology that is created, AI also has a couple of risks. In fact, some of the smartest people in the world have expressed their concerns about this development. Elon Musk thinks that it's our biggest existential threat. And Bill Gates agrees with him, and he doesn't understand why some people are not concerned. And Stephen Hawking, who died last year, he thought that it would either be the best or the worst thing ever to happen to us. And for me, this was one of the reasons to start learning about this, because I thought if these people are concerned, I want to at least know what it is about. And from everything I read and seen, I think there are two main categories of risks in AI. And first is the short-term risks, and those are things that we can all understand. And then you have the hopefully longer-term risks, and that's where it requires a bit more imagination. But let's start with the short-term. What can we expect from AI in the upcoming years? So one thing that we'll see is that jobs will be taken over by machines. Now, that in itself is nothing new. We've seen that before. In the Industrial Revolution, jobs have been taken over by machines. When computers were invented, jobs have been taken over. So that's nothing new. But what makes it different this time is that the transition might go a lot faster. With the Industrial Revolution, we had 100 years to find new jobs for humans. With the invention of computers, a couple of decades. But with AI, we might only have 10 more years before the complete job market looks different. And the problem will not be to find new jobs. There will be new jobs, as always. But the question is, will there be jobs that a computer or that a human does better than a computer? Because AI is not just some productivity improvement tool for us, but instead it can do intelligent jobs that we so far think can only be done by humans. So on the bluish areas of this map, 80% of the jobs consist of services that we are now teaching to machines. And you can think of things like warehousing, driving a vehicle, but also food preparation and medical diagnosis, and even finding legal precedents, all things that today we are using AI for. So this is going to be a big challenge, probably for us, but I think definitely the generation of our children will get to deal with this. Another risk is following blindly the advice of AI. Right now we're already using algorithms to determine who gets a job, who gets fired, who gets a loan, who gets an insurance, what prisoner can go on a parole, etc. More and more cities are using the concept of smart policing, where they use algorithms to determine on what location it is most likely that a crime will occur, or what person is most likely to commit a crime, and that almost sounds a bit like Minority Report, if you know the movie. And that all sounds nice, could be nice, but there is also a risk, because what data was used to train these algorithms? Because if that data contains biases, historically, and we train the machines, then the machines will just apply those biases. So this is a risk that particularly affects women and minorities. And as an example, there has been... sorry. Yeah, I'm the blonde guy, so I can laugh about this. As an example, there has been an AI beauty contest where the computer chose predominantly white faces as a winner. So there's a risk there. Another risk is group profiling and group manipulation. Now, we now all know the company Cambridge Analytica. I don't even think it still exists. Their slogan was using data to change audience behavior. And they were pretty effective at that. So what they did, they created profiles of humans based on their behavior on Facebook. And with those profiles of the humans, they targeted them with specific customized advertisements to change their behavior, to change their opinion about things. And they were pretty effective at that because they were used at both the Trump campaign and allegedly also in the Brexit campaign. And one of the tools that AI offers to change people's opinion is the generation of fake news and deepfakes. And deepfakes is a technology where you create highly believable videos where you change the face of an actor with the face of somebody else. And to show how easy it is to do that, some guy used this technology to swap the face of Anne Hathaway in a scene from Get Smart with the face of his girlfriend. And as you see, the one on the right is a fake, but it's pretty hard to spot that this is a fake. Again, imagine what this can do in 10 years. So I think all upcoming elections are going to be affected by this. There's also videos online that you can find from Barack Obama and other famous people that are saying things that they never actually said. So it's really a big risk. It's going to become harder and harder to spot what is real and what is not in the world. Next risk speaks for itself, I guess, autonomous weapons. It's already a risk because semi-autonomous drones are already killing dozens of people every year. Three of these machines, Foster Miller swords, have been removed from the battlefield in Iraq during the American-Iraqi occupation because they allegedly started targeting their own people. So it's already a risk. But the risk will grow when we give these devices more intelligence and more autonomy. And if you want to see a scary video of what that may lead to, you can look up the Slaughterbots movie on YouTube. It's not a real video, but it shows you a realistic scenario with technology that is available already today. And right now there's already 50 countries, no more than 50 countries, that are developing battlefield robots. And if you see what a company like Boston Dynamics can already do with robotics, then yeah, it doesn't require a lot of imagination to think of how this could become a threat to us. And again, imagine what these machines can do in 10 years. It's pretty amazing. And that one can do something that most of us can't do, probably. So these are all risks that we can easily understand. But there is also the risk of something called artificial superintelligence. And this is the path that experts see to superintelligence. And you have three steps. First, we have narrow intelligence, then general intelligence, and then artificial superintelligence. Narrow intelligence is where we are today. So those are machines that can do one thing very well, maybe as good as a human, maybe even better, but they can do only one thing. Examples are a chess computer, a translation machine, image recognition systems, things like that. Everything we have seen and discussed so far, all related to narrow intelligence. And then the next step would be artificial general intelligence, and that is a huge step, because that would mean a machine that is as intelligent as a human, but then over the entire spectrum of our intelligence. Now, it's not even sure if we're ever going to reach that, because it's going to be a big challenge, but on average, experts believe that it can be done by 2040. And then the next step would be artificial superintelligence, and that would be a machine that's way more intelligent than a human. And again, it's not sure if we're ever going to make it. There's even a discussion going on how much time there would be between general intelligence and superintelligence. Some say a matter of hours, and others say decades, but on average, experts believe that it can be done by 2060. Ray Kurzweil, by the way, the guy with the 86 correct predictions, he's a bit more optimistic because he thinks that we will reach general intelligence in 10 years when we have a successful Turing test. And he thinks that we will become super intelligent ourselves when we merge with the technology in 2045 in an event he calls the singularity. Sounds a bit like science fiction, but yeah, 86% chance. And so, yeah. Of course, there are a lot of people that will be outsmarted a bit sooner. but if you believe the people who are skeptical about this technology, this is actually representative of, or how do you say, comparable to how we're now dealing with AI, because we're mainly focused on the benefits of it and we're kind of ignoring the risks involved. But okay, this is just a joke, of course. What would be required for reaching general intelligence? Well, actually only two things. We need fast hardware, and we need software that can do the same as our brain, and then we're there. And the hardware we already have, more or less, because the estimated capacity of the human brain is 38 petaflops, so that's a measure of how many operations it can do in a second. And the fastest supercomputer currently is deployed last year, the IBM Summit, has a capacity of 200 petaflops. So speed-wise, we are there. It's just that these machines are not very practical, because they are huge, they consume a tremendous amount of energy, and they cost a fortune. So we need to bring it down to a more portable scale. And that's going to be a challenge, but we did it before. Because remember, the first computers were also wall-filling machines, way bigger, use way more energy, cost a lot more money, and were a lot slower than the phone everybody has now in its pocket. So we did it before, and we did it with the knowledge and technology from the previous century. So I think it should be possible to do it again. To give you an idea, the iPad 2 that was released in 2011 had the same computational power as the fastest supercomputer in 1994. So to give you an idea of how much time it could take to put the power of this machine into your pockets. And of course, the human brain works in a way a different way than a computer. And therefore, IBM and Intel and other companies are also trying to find different types of chips that work more in the way that our brain works. So it's going to be a challenge, but I think give it enough time and investments, we will be there with the hardware. And then the next challenge would be the software. And right now, there are multiple projects going on in the world that are trying to reverse engineer our brain. So see how the brain works and try to do that in a computer. And right now, they are making very slow progress, and I think they're working on the level of mice and rats. But these projects are often compared to the Human Genome Project, the project where we tried to identify the entire human DNA structure. And in 1988, when that project started, it was thought by a lot of people that it would be impossible to do, because we didn't have the technology and the knowledge to do it. So there were a lot of skeptical people, and 1 year into this project, only 0.01% of the DNA was identified. And then 7 years into the project, only 1% was identified. And then a lot of criticals were speaking up because they thought, if after 7 years you've only reached 1%, it's going to take hundreds of years before you're done. But these people did not take into account the law of accelerating returns. Because law of accelerating returns says if you've reached 1% of your project, it takes you 7 more multiplications, and then you're at 100%. And so it happened that 8 years later, not 100 years, but 8 years later, 15 years after the project has started, 99% of the human DNA was identified. And The project that are now trying to reverse engineer our brain could follow a similar pattern, making slow progress now, but when technology evolves, they might have new tools to work on it and it might go a lot faster. But it's going to be a big challenge, of course, because yeah, we don't know a lot about the human brain currently, but we do know that it's very complex. But sometimes there is an easy algorithm for complexity. Take, for example, astronomy. In the 16th century, people could look at the sky and they saw a lot of objects and they saw different movements, but they couldn't explain it. They couldn't explain all the complexity of these movements. They saw, yeah, the Earth was revolving around the Sun, we had a Moon revolving around the Earth, all other planets with different motions, we had the stars, we had comets shooting through the sky and disappearing, and they could not explain all the complexity of these movements. And then in the 17th century, Isaac Newton, he formulated his theory of universal gravitation. And then all of a sudden, it appeared that all the complexity of these movements could be explained with a relatively simple set of principles. So maybe there is also a simple algorithm behind our intelligence. And in a way, that would make sense, right? Because the human brain contains 100 billion neurons with 100 trillion connections between these neurons. And our DNA simply doesn't have enough information to contain a detailed layout of this, or a detailed description of this layout. So maybe our DNA contains only a global architecture of the brain and some simple algorithms of how to make connections between neurons, and maybe that is what explains how we are intelligent. A couple of neuroscientists like Joe Chen of the Augusta University in Georgia really believe that such an algorithm exists. So, superintelligence, it is controversial, but it is not impossible. There's no law of physics that says it cannot be done. But what is it? Now that's I can try to explain using this somewhat arbitrary intelligence staircase. So we humans, we know different forms of intelligence, and they all have one thing in common, and that's that they're way lower than ours. And a higher level of intelligence does not mean faster thinking, but it means a complete different level of intelligence. So we humans, we have language, music, we can do abstract thinking, we can plan ahead. Those are things that a chimpanzee doesn't have, or at least a lot less. And even if you would make the brain of a chimpanzee 1,000 times faster, he would still not be on our level. So a chimp could walk around in our world, but you will never be able to understand that we create phones or laptops or buildings, or that we hold meetings to share information with each other. Concepts that a chimpanzee just doesn't have. Now imagine a machine that would be two steps above us. It would only be slightly super intelligent, but just it we to a chimp, it would be to us, yeah, like we are to chimps. So we would also not be able to understand the concepts that such a machine works with. Let alone a machine seven steps above us, that would be to us like we are to ants. But the real artificial superintelligence goes way further than that, and is actually totally off any biological scale. And with that huge amount of intelligence, there are two possible outcomes for us. And that is either we go extinct, or we live forever. And again, I'm not making this up myself. There are scientists who believe not so much, or they're asking themselves not so much if this will happen, but more when it will happen. So let's start with the bad news. There is a chance that we might go extinct. Well, it doesn't sound as bad as, or it isn't as bad as it sounds, because yeah, 99.9% of all the species that ever existed have gone extinct. So it is a fairly normal path for a species to go. Yeah, and sometimes it happens because a meteorite strikes the Earth, like for the dinosaurs. But it could also happen that a new species arises and becomes a threat to an existing species. And that doesn't mean that the new species is evil, so you don't have to think of Skynet or Terminator robots that are trying to eliminate us. It's not going to be like that. It could just be that the new species is more powerful and has different goals than an existing species, and in that way it could become a threat. We humans have caused the extinction of a lot of animals, and we don't feel evil about it, or at least most of us don't. So we don't see ourselves as evil, it's just that we have different goals than the animals and we're smarter, so yeah, that's bad luck for them. And in the same comparison, a super intelligence could also become a threat to us, not because it's evil to us, but all it takes is for it to be more intelligent than us and have its goals not aligned with ours, and that could already be a big problem for us. Okay, but there's also a silver lining. There is also good news, because there is also a chance that we might live forever. Yeah, because if we somehow manage to keep the super intelligence under control, and we somehow manage to teach it some respect for human life, then we can use it to achieve great things. Because we can use it to solve big world problems like the energy problem, the world food problem, climate problem. We could use it to find cures for diseases. We could even use it to revert our aging, and in that way we could live way longer. And there's even scientists who believe that we eventually can upload our brain into a computer and live digitally ever after. So, again, not making this up myself. And if that happens, if we somehow get eternal life, then there's one more thing that we will do, and that is we will go into space. Because we've already been on the moon, and we are now making plans to go to Mars. So if we have eternal life, we will definitely go into space, into the universe, to find more resources. And that takes us to the last slide of this talk, and that is about Fermi paradox. Who knows what Fermi paradox is? Only a few. Okay, so too bad. Then I have to tell the truth, otherwise I could make up a story. So the Fermi paradox says something about the chance that we are alone in the universe. And in a way, it also says something about the chance that we will ever reach artificial superintelligence. And I can explain it a bit like this. If you look at the sky on a clear night, you can see about 2,500 stars. But that is only a very small part of the total number of stars in our Milky Way galaxy. And roughly for each star in our galaxy, there is a complete other galaxy out there somewhere in the universe. And that brings the total number of stars to an insanely high number. Now, some of those stars will be stars like our own sun. And some of those sun-like stars will have a planet revolving around it just like our Earth. And a conservative estimate says that for every grain of sand on every beach on Earth, there are 100 Earth-like planets out there in the universe. So that is a nice one to take with you next time you're on a beach. And then if we take it a bit further, you can use the Drake equation, because some of these planets will develop life, just like it happened here. And some of that life will become intelligent. And using the Drake equation, it is estimated that there are 10 million billion intelligent civilizations in the universe, or if we take it a bit more local, 100,000 in our Milky Way galaxy. And with that many intelligent civilizations out there, there's only one question remaining, and that is there anybody willing to take over this clown from us? No, that's not the real question. Now, if there are so many intelligent civilizations out there, then some of them must also have reached our level of intelligence. And if they did, then they also must have developed artificial superintelligence. And if they did, they must also have gone into space, into the universe, in search for more resources. And then the real question of the Fermi paradox is, yeah, where is everybody? Now, there's a lot of different theories about this, a very interesting topic. Could easily talk another hour for it, but I think it's outside the scope of this talk. So I want to leave it at this. I want to thank you all for coming here on this early hour. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, you can either come to me right now or talk to me later on the day. I'll be walking around. So thank you very much. Enjoy your day at FutureTech.